Today we have the pleasure to welcome Gaël Lemons, I did my best there.
Very good.
Gaël is full professor at the Department of Economics and Business of the Pompeu Fabra University in Barcelona, Spain, where he also is an affiliated professor at the Graduate School of Economics and at the Barcelona School of Management. Gaël's main research interest center around two broad topics: the social dynamics of organizations, for which he has examined the social processes of technological trajectories, the evolution of cultural tastes and their consequence for organizational viability, and the dynamics of organizational failure, and the psychology of decision making. An important research focus in this area studies how individuals rely on experience to form beliefs that help individuals when facing a particular decision problem, and how the social context contributes to shaping the access to certain experiences. We would like to remind the participants of the seminar to mute their microphones until the end of the session, unless you have any clarification question you may want to ask. You will be able to unmute your microphone to ask questions once the presentation is over. Please, for that, use the function raise hand to indicate that you have a question. For your information, the presentation is being recorded. Without further ado, Gaël, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Alex, for the nice introduction. Thank you, Carly, for the invitation. It's my pleasure to share some of my research with you today. So, if we were not in COVID times, I would have come here to Sweden, and I would have arrived yesterday. Most likely, I would have gone to some dinner, I would have tried out some restaurant. And let's suppose that I go to a restaurant, I'm on my own, I order some food, and I don't like it. It's a bad experience. The food is not good, and I tell myself, tomorrow I will not return to this restaurant. Now, the next day, I come to the department, I give my seminar, I have a bunch of interesting meetings with colleagues, and in the evening, they bring me to a restaurant. As it happens, this is the same restaurant as the one I went to the day before. Now, obviously, I want to spend some time with my host. I want to have some interesting conversations with the colleagues. I don't tell them I didn't like it yesterday when I went. Okay? So I go again, I order some different dish, and I like them. And I discover that this restaurant is not that bad after all. So what is a crucial aspect of this story? That I did not have to be convinced by the host, by the colleagues, that the restaurant is good to change my mind about the restaurant. What happened is that because I wanted to spend time with the colleagues, I went with them again to the restaurant. I sampled the restaurant again, and doing so, I was exposed to additional information about the restaurant. I had a negative opinion, but because of this additional information, this additional exposure, I could revise this negative opinion I had initially. Okay? The basic mechanism here is that exposure to information caused by the social environment can correct negative opinions that otherwise would have gone unchallenged. So this basic mechanism of corrections of negative impressions, negative opinions, negative attitudes is at the core of an approach to human judgment I have contributed to develop with other researchers. The sampling approach. So what is the idea of the sampling approach? It explains phenomena such as the in-group, out-group bias, social influence, or illusory correlations, by analyzing how past experiences and the social environment systematically affect the samples of information that people have access to. Okay? So this focus on the sample of information is different in contrast to the dominant research traditions on human judgments, such as cognitive and social psychology or behavioral economics. These traditions focus on how people process information, maybe how the social environment affects how people process information. Okay? By contrast here, we do not unpack what's happening in the mind of the people. We will make some very simple assumptions about how people process information, and we will focus on the effect of the interaction of past experiences and the social environment on the samples of information that people collect from their environment. Okay, so in a way, the work in this sampling approach tradition ignores the complexities of how their minds processes information. In that sense, it's very much sociological, it's very much structural, as opposed to psychological. Okay. Now, obviously, understanding how the environment affects access to information is important. And I'm actually quite happy to realize that in the past few years, this set of ideas has made it to the mainstream. Not that I was a causal factor to it. It was an independent movement to the mainstream, mostly triggered by a work on filter bubbles or the filter bubble hypothesis by Elie Pariser and Cass Sunstein. That is a claim that people tend to be exposed to information, to opinions that are mostly consistent with their own opinions. Okay? And the claim is that social media reinforces this selective exposure to information that is consistent with people's opinions and this lack of exposure to contrarian opinions. And by the way, the mechanism posited by these authors is the combination of homophily of the structure of our connections on social media, on Facebook, Twitter, and so forth, right? And of the working of the algorithms that might be designed to reinforce people's opinions because they are designed to be consistent, to make people happy. And as we know, people don't like to be exposed to contrarian opinions most of the time, okay? But all the technologies do impact or control or access to information. Think of Google Scholar. Who among you has not been surprised by the suggestions of Google Scholars about what should be the next paper you should read? If you go on the Google Scholar page, you'll see some suggested papers, and Google Scholar is quite spot on. It suggests papers I will like. When I read this paper, I don't read other papers that might operate in different research traditions. Okay. Okay. So the goal of these technologies, right? These recommendation systems, these algorithms that regulate the news feed we see on Facebook, is to help our choice, to help our satisfaction by avoiding us the need to sample things we will not like. But when we will not sample things we will not like, we do not discover new things, right? Okay, so what I want to talk about today in the first part of the talk is how a sampling approach could explain the following frequently observed phenomenon that alternatives which are popular tend to be evaluated more positively than alternatives which are less popular. Popular artists tend to be evaluated more positively than unpopular artists. Popular researchers tend to be evaluated more positively than unpopular researchers, and so forth. Okay. Now to address this issue, okay, we're going to look at the following process. We're going to look at a person, let's call her Julie, okay, who forms her impression about a restaurant. Okay, so suppose that Julie went to a restaurant, she had a good experience, then she asked herself the following question: will I sample this restaurant again? Will I try it again? Okay, will I go again? Now, if she goes again, she will have a chance to update her evaluation of this restaurant. But if she doesn't go again, she will not get additional information. She will not update her evaluation of that restaurant. So here, this process of sampling contingent on the current evaluation is characterized by an important asymmetry. And here's the asymmetry. If the initial impression is low, the agent is unlikely to sample again. Now, if the agent is unlikely to sample again, she's unlikely to obtain additional information that will correct this negative impression. Now, the impression is high, she's likely to sample again. But given that the impression is high, it could have been an overestimation. She samples again, she tries again, she gets some more information. And on average, the impression is likely to go down due to the regression to the mean inherent in the randomness of this process. This asymmetry, the fact that low impressions tend to be sticky, they tend to be less corrected because they are followed by avoidance, an absence of acquisition of additional information. Whereas high impressions tend to be corrected because they lead to more acquisition of information, implies that low evaluations will be more persistent than high evaluations. Okay? So overall, if we put all these things together, we can demonstrate that this leads to a systematic underestimation of uncertain alternative. Okay? So that was the point that was most famously made by Dirk Lendenrell, my former advisor, in the Psychological Review paper in 2005. That was a follow-up to the hot stove paper with Jim March. Okay, so hot stove, this is a label to this phenomenon. It's named in by reference and in honor of the Mark Twain's cat who burnt herself on a hot stove. And after burning herself on the hot stove, she concluded that all stoves are hot. So she would never get too close to a stove any longer. She will never discover that some stoves are just warm and that she would be better off by standing close to the warm stove in the cold winter. Okay, so now, so far, we looked at the example of an agent, okay, who made a sequence of sampling decisions and updated their opinion of an alternative, namely a restaurant here, on the basis of the information she collected. Now we want to put this agent in some sort of social structure. Okay, so we are going to assume that some other agents have evaluated this restaurant again. Okay. Now suppose that this restaurant is popular. Okay. Julie went to the restaurant. She didn't like it. The restaurant is popular. Will she go again? If she's like me, who would come in my pre or post COVID-19 world to a place and would want to go again to a restaurant to spend time with a colleague, she might still go to spend time with these other agents here, right? Now, if she goes again, she will gather some additional information and she might correct her negative impression. Okay, so if the impression was low, she might still go again because the restaurant is popular. If she goes again, she collects some more information. This information might change her mind. Okay, she and most of the time, the impression will go up due to the regression shown to the mean phenomenon. Now, errors of underestimation are therefore unlikely to persist if the alternative is already popular. You went there, you didn't like it, you want to avoid it, but it's popular, and because it's popular, you go to there again. Therefore, you gain some more information. Suppose now that the restaurant is unpopular. Julie went there, has a low impression. She had a bad impression, and the restaurant is unpopular. Why would she ever go there again? In this case, she's unlikely to sample again, and the impression is unlikely to go up, right? So errors of underestimations are likely to persist when the alternative is unpopular. Okay, so now we have a systematic difference between popular and unpopular alternatives. This difference in opportunities for error corrections in the case of underestimations, okay, will imply that popular alternatives will tend to be estimated more positively than unpopular alternatives as per this mechanism, okay? So here, what I outlined, what I explained is a pure sampling-based mechanism. We had no informational social influence. Julie did not have to be convinced by the other people that the restaurant is good to change her mind. They had to convince her to go again, to try again for herself. But they didn't have to persuade her that it is good. Okay? Julie didn't make any inference about quality on the basis of popularity. She didn't think, oh, this restaurant is good because everybody goes there. Okay? She just went there because everybody goes there and then updated her belief or her impression on the basis of the information she sampled herself, right? So by the way, the second class of mechanisms is the class of the class of mechanisms that economists call social learning, okay? That is at the core of information cascades phenomenon, okay? Third, there was no motivated cognition, okay? Julie is not motivated to interpret the information in a way that is consistent with the popularity of the option, okay? It's not because the restaurant is popular that she changes how she interprets the information she samples, okay? So, obviously here I didn't present a formal model, right? I presented a verbal rendition of what could be a simple formal model, okay? But we did not allow for any of these mechanisms to operate. Yet, there's an emergent phenomenon, which is a more positive evaluation of already popular activity. Okay, so when is that happening? Okay, it doesn't happen all the time. So now we want to go a little bit more into details, okay? So if we assume, now we want to look at the sampling rule, okay? I said the sampling rule, the probability that Julie samples the alternative again, is a function of two things, her past evaluation in the previous period and of the popularity. Okay, so now we're going to write this sampling probability as a ratio, okay, of, here's the numerator, what is this? This is the attractiveness or the utility, so to say, of the option, the target option. Qi hat, this is the evaluation, the perceived quality, so to say. Pi, this is the popularity. And then it's divided by the sum of the attractiveness of all the candidate options, okay? So when we have these ratio rules, we will say that Julie is more likely to select option I when alpha Qi pi I is larger, relatively larger than this other, than the attractiveness for the other options, okay? Now, if you do a lot of math, and I will spare you the mathematical details for this, we can show, okay, that if alpha is a compensatory utility function, we will have a positive effect of popularity on quality estimates, okay? What does that mean, that it is a compensatory utility function? That means that Julie will find the restaurant attractive to go, even if she didn't like it, but it's popular. Popularity can compensate a negative impression. A positive impression can compensate a lack of popularity. She might go to a place if she likes it, even if it's unpopular among your social circle, okay? So if alpha is a compensatory utility function, okay, so mathematically, we would basically take the cross derivative of the log of alpha, okay? And if the cross derivative of the log of alpha is negative, that would correspond to compensatory utility function, okay? We will have a positive effect of popularity and quality estimates, okay? Now, if alpha is a strongly non-compensatory utility function, the effect will be the reverse, okay? What does that mean, non-compensatory? That means that popularity cannot compensate a low evaluation, okay? No, an example would be an AND function. Julie would go to the restaurant if both conditions are satisfied, she likes it, and it's popular, okay? So that would be the extreme of the non-compensatory utility function, okay? In this case, what we would see is that the options that are less popular tend to be more positively valued. Options which are more popular will be less positively valued, okay? Then we might ask ourselves, what is the form of this alpha function in naturally occurring environment? What can we do about that, okay? So for a very long time, I had this paper with the theoretical models, predictions, mathematical derivations. It was reject and resubmit from psychological review twice. And then I had no data to sort of illustrate this. And some years ago came along somebody who now is my co-author, Yulia Karaman, came to give a job talk at Pompeu, and she happened to have exactly the data I needed to have a look at this. Okay? And the data she had was data from a loyalty program of clients of a large group of hotel chains. Okay? So it's a really large group of hotel chains. There are 4,000 hotels and hundreds of thousands of people in this data set, right? So now what we looked at is how does the opinion of these patrons to hotels affect their decision to sample the hotel again, okay? So as it happens, we had about half a million people who gave the rating of a first hotel, a first stay in a given hotel of the group, okay? And then what we did, so we took this rating as the evaluation at IT. We took the number of ratings on TripAdvisor for that hotel over the year before our period, before the first day, as a measure of popularity, and we try to predict whether the person is returning to the hotel or not in the next 6 months as a function of her evaluation and the popularity. Okay. Now, as it happens, if you do a logistic regression, okay, this ratio, okay, if you say alpha is going to be the exponential of a linear function, okay, and this linear function will have two main effects, evaluation and popularity, and an interaction term, evaluation times popularity, the coefficient of the interaction term, okay, will exactly tell us if alpha is compensatory or not. Okay, so now I didn't put the details here because I want to talk about some other topics in the rest of this talk. But what we found is that alpha is a compensatory utility function in this set. Okay? Namely, people, the popularity of a hotel compensated for negative rating of the first day in people's behavior, in the probability, when we try to model the probability that people go back to the hotel. Okay? Okay, so now what did I say so far? I illustrated the process according to which the social environment makes people more exposed to additional information because it essentially motivates them or forces them to sample again an alternative. Okay, and this additional exposure contributes to explaining a positive association between popularity and valuation. Okay. Now I want to move to a different effect of the social environment. Okay? We are going to look at the feedback that the social environment provides to you when you engage in some kind of behavior. Okay? Now, what we are going to focus on, this is how people behave on Twitter. And our setting here, and this is the setting I'm going to use for the illustration because this is also the setting we use for empirical paper, is a politician who selects the topics of the tweets she publishes. Okay? Then she publishes a tweet, she observes the feedback from other users in terms of retweets and likes, and then she adjusts the amount of attention she allocates to different topics. So what we posit is that when a politician writes about a particular topic and this topic is relatively well received in the sense that she gets more retweets, more likes, she's likely to write more tweets about that topic, and she is likely to avoid topics for which she got negative feedback in terms of few retweets, few likes, or many bad replies, okay, negative replies. So now we're going to take a particular example here. This particular example, again, is informed by the empirical analysis I'm going to share with you a little bit later. This is the topic of gender issues. Okay? So we are going to look at the sequence of tweets that politicians post, okay? And we're going to wonder for each tweet, is this tweet about gender issues or not about gender issues, okay? And what we want to explain is it the case that politicians allocate their attention to gender issues? Political scientists call that issue attention to a particular issue, okay? As a function of the feedback they obtain on Twitter, okay? So we are going to model this in the same way that we did before for Julie and the restaurant, right? So our agent here, in every period, makes a decision about the, so each period, sorry, the tweet, okay? And the decision she makes is whether the tweet is about gender issues or not, okay? She writes a tweet. If she gets, she writes a tweet about gender issues, she gets some feedback about this tweet and she updates her evaluation of this topic. If she wrote a tweet about a different topic, she will update evaluation of the other topics, but not the evaluation of the gender issue, okay? Now, what are we interested in here? So suppose we have two politicians. We have F here and M, okay? F obviously stands for female politician, M male politician. Now, if F receives more positive feedback than M for writing about gender issues, right? We would expect that F is more reinforced for writing on gender issues, and therefore F should write more about gender issues than M. In other words, the attention that F allocates to gender issues should be larger than the attention that M allocates to gender issues, okay? So if we have a difference in feedback for in the valence of the feedback for F and M, okay, this is likely to lead to differential valuations of the topic by F and M, and it could lead to systematic difference in behavior, okay? F, in this case, is likely to write more about the gender issue than M, okay? So now, what I'm going to show you first is a snippet of the macro behavior we see among actual Spanish politicians, and then I'm going to unpack the actual belief model that we use and then show you the estimation results and so on, okay? So we collected all the tweets published by all elected Spanish representatives during 2016 and from 2016 to 2019, okay? Over, it was an election cycle, okay? So we had the Spanish representatives at the national parliament and at the regional parliaments. We could not track the Twitter account of all of them. There were like a bit fewer than 1,600 representatives. We found Twitter accounts for 1,274, okay? 1.5 million tweets, okay? Then for the 1.5 million tweets, we had to code them whether they were on the topic of gender issues or not, okay? For this, we trained some research assistants to code 20,000 tweets, and then we used a deep learning classifier based on the BERT model. That's basically state-of-the-art natural language representation, okay, to predict whether tweets were about the gender topic or not. Okay, in fact, our trained classifier performed very well. The validation, the accuracy, out of sample accuracy on the validation set is 98%. Okay, and if you're familiar with machine learning metrics, the F1 metric is like 0.88. And we, last point about performance here, our classifier, the inter-rater reliability, so to say the Cronbach alpha between our classifier on our research assistants is about the same as in between two research assistants. We are quite confident that our classifier makes topic judgments in a way that maps fairly well what humans would do, okay? So what do we have here? Once we tag all these tweets as being about gender issues or not, okay? We can just look at the basic proportion of tweets on gender issues. And we find that female politicians indeed write about three times more tweets about gender issues than male politicians. And obviously there are many possible explanations for this, but we can return to that a little bit later, okay? Now, what I want to present to you is our perspective on how this difference between male and female politicians could come about, okay? So now we are going to model the process of topic choice as, if you're familiar with this, as a two-arm bandit problem, okay? So in each period, the politician makes a choice between two options, namely the gender topic or the other topic that is bundled as a big, broad other category. If the politician selects a topic, and she is going to get some feedback in terms of retweets and likes, and she will update her valuation as a function of the feedback she got, right? So what do we assume here? That the new valuation is a weighted average of the past valuation and the feedback, with beta is the weight of the feedback here, okay? The higher beta, the strongest the updating, the lower beta, slowest the update, okay? Then if the politician writes a tweet on a different, tweet T on a different topic, okay? So if the topic is not K, I'm saying that there is a typo here, okay? The topic is different from K, okay? The valuation does not change, okay? Now, here, these two equations are about valuation updating as a function of the feedback, and we need also to model the choice. We're going to assume that the choice follows a logistic choice rule or softmax that is specified as follows, okay? It's basically the probability that she writes about the gender topic is a function of the difference in valuation of the gender topic and of the other topic, okay? Pi G here characterizes the baseline propensity to write about the topic G, gender, and R is a slow parameter that characterizes the sensitivity of the choice to the difference in valuation, right? So now, in a logistic model specification, right? So that would be the constant term, and that would be the coefficient of the difference in valuation, right? Now, if we make some particular distributional assumption, we can do some mathematical derivations. Now, if we assume that the feedback here follows normal distributions, okay? And for simplicity, we assume that the normal distribution has the same standard deviation, different mean, namely that, so mu j is different from mu o here, okay? We can take this model and compute the asymptotic distribution of belief and asymptotic probability of choosing G, okay? This is what we will call the asymptotic attention to the gender topic. And it's really nice because after you do all the integrations of all this term, basically what you get is that the proportion of tweets diverted to the gender topic follows this really easy to interpret formula, right? Well, you have pi g here, which was the same as in the choice rule. And here we have the difference in means of the payoff distribution, okay? So now let's go back to our two agents. We have F and N, right? The asymptotic issue attention for each agent is given by this formula, okay? By the way, this is increasing in that part, right? Because it's simply a logistic function, okay? Now, the asymptotic issue attention given by the agent F will be larger than the asymptotic attention to gender issues by gender M if this is larger for F, right? So now we are not interested in this process, in this analysis, we're not interested in systematic baseline differences between female and male behavior, okay? We're only interested in the effect of feedback, right? So there will be a feedback-induced gap in issue attention when RF the sensitivity of the choice to difference in variations for H of F times the gender issue feedback advantage for F is larger than the same product for N. Okay? So now we have some conditions, basically, that we derive from our model, okay, that are necessary for an emergence of a feedback-induced difference in issue at large. Okay? So, and the question is, how did this politician behave? Okay? What kind of feedback were they exposed to? Okay? And how did they react to the feedback? Okay? So again, so that's basically the descriptive statistics of the difference in behavior. But now what we want to do is we want to estimate, we want to look at the feedback that male and female politicians were exposed to and estimate the parameters of the choice rule, okay, to see whether we are within these conditions or not. Okay? So now, to measure the feedback received by a tweet, right? I mean, so you're not psychologists, so none of this will be surprising to you. If you do that in a laboratory experiment, it will be very easy, but obviously here it's naturally occurring environment. We have to take out a lot of heterogeneity between these people and so forth, right? So how are we going to construct a measure of feedback? We take the number of retweets, we take the log. Now we want to take out some politician-specific time trend because they might adjust to what happened to them in the past, okay? And then we are going to do within politician normalization, okay? To account for the fact that some politicians have many more followers than others. Therefore, the amount of retweets they get is much larger than other politicians, okay? So this within politician normalization is quite important here, okay? And by the way, when we take the log, we assume that politicians don't try to write, they're not particularly sensitive to viral tweets, right? We assume that they pay less attention to extreme outcomes. Something up for discussion, obviously, right? So anyway, so we did assumption that distribution of feedback has mean zero and standard deviation one, and it's basically more or less normal, right? What does it mean? A one unit increase in feedback means that the tweet received one standard deviation more in feedback utility units relative to other tweets written by the same politician around the same point in time. Okay? So here are some descriptive statistics, okay? So we have female politicians, male politicians. Let's look at the average number of retweets that they get for gender issue tweets and other tweets, okay? So female politicians get more retweets for writing on gender issues than male politicians. It's not really than other issues, sorry, but there's not much of a difference for male politicians, okay? There is, that's basically it. And we have a similar pattern for likes, right? By the way, female politicians tend to write a lower overall volume of tweets than male politicians, okay? Okay, so now, these are just descriptive statistics, but what I'm going to show you is some linear regressions where the dependent variable is the amount of feedback. Okay, we're going to regress these on the topic of the tweet, the gender of the politician, and the interaction between topic and gender, right? So what we are really interested in here, okay, is this interaction term, okay? Do female politicians get relatively more rewarded for writing about the gender issue than male politicians? If this is the case, we should have a negative coefficient, okay? So now I would like to attract your attention onto model two here, right? Where we do this regression, we include politician fixed effect and day fixed effect, okay? To take out between politician variation and systematic period effects. And the Spaniards here in the audience, you'll tell me, I'm sure in your mind you're thinking, International Women's Day is really a big deal in Spain, and there is a lot of activity online around this time. Yes, it is the case, right? And that's why it's quite important to to take out systematic and periodic variations in the form of including day fixed effect here. Okay. So what we find here is that politicians of both genders tend to get more retweets, more positive feedback for writing about gender issues. Okay. But it's larger for female politicians. For female politicians, the gender issue advantage in feedback is 0.29. For male politicians, it's 0.29 minus 0.12, right? It's about 0.16. Okay? The gender issue feedback advantage for female politicians, 0.29. Gender issue feedback advantage for male politicians is 0.16. Okay? So now, we go back to our little model-based prediction conditions, right? So we have an asymmetry in feedback, okay? Now, this product is only going to be larger than the right-hand side if female politicians do not react much less than male politicians to feedback. If RF is much lower than RM, this condition might not hold, okay? So it's quite important to also estimate how these politicians react to feedback, okay? Remember a little choice model, where the probability that the topic of a tweet is a G is a logistic choice rule, right? And we have some belief updating rule here, okay? So now the way we are going to estimate this model is not exactly the way I specified it in the theory part, so to say. Okay. We're not going to look at, we're not going to predict the topic of each tweet, but we're going to aggregate the data over a certain time period. What I'm going to show you is results we obtained by months. Okay. We're going to predict the proportion of tweets on gender issues in a given month as a function of the evaluations for gender issues and other issues at the beginning of the month. Okay. Why do we do this instead of estimating a model where we predict the topic of each tweet? It's because we want to be able to put in period fixed effects in our regression. Okay, so it's a technical consideration that leads us to aggregating the data for estimation of it. Okay. So basically, we are going to make a joint estimation of this logistic regression with fixed effect and with the belief model by maximum likelihood. Okay, so we do a grid search with various values of this belief model. For each value of this, we compute the valuation, we estimate the logit model with fixed effect, okay, and we do that many times, and we basically find the model that gives us overall best likelihood. Okay. Now, what do we find? I'm attracting your attention here onto model two here. Model two would be the difference in valuation of gender topic minus other topic for female politicians. Okay. And that is the difference in valuation for male politicians. Okay. We find that politicians of both genders are sensitive to differences in valuation, okay? But female politicians are more sensitive to differences in valuations than male politicians, okay? And then here, I'm not going to spend time on the other parts of this table. This is to look at whether what matters more is the feedback on gender issues versus feedback to tweets on other topics. And we find that what drives most of the effect is the feedback on gender issue tweet more than the feedback on the other topics, okay? Okay, so now what do we have? We have 0.11, 0.29, 0.07, 0.16, okay? So clearly, if we take the product of these two, it's larger than the product on the right-hand side, okay? So overall, the empirical pattern of exposure to feedback by female and male politicians and how they react to feedback in adjusting the topics of the tweets is consistent with the observed asymmetry, the observed difference in issue attention by male and female politicians. By the way, just to finish to connect to other possible explanations for the difference, right? So what we observe here is a divergence over time. Okay? Male politicians write more and more about gender issues, okay? But the slope is quite is increasing quite a bit faster for female politicians, right? So now if we try to explain this difference that we see on the left on the basis of a difference in identities, female politicians care more about gender issues because gender issues are talk mostly about the situation of women, for example, okay? Or female politicians care more about gender issues because they mostly care more about their female constituents who care more about gender issues, okay? That could be explanations, these identity-based explanations could explain this difference, right? But it would be somewhat a pain to explain a divergence over time, right? Unless we assume that the identities change extremely fast over this period, okay? Okay, so in conclusion for this part of the talk, right? What did we talk about? We talk about how the social environment produces feedback to these politicians and produces systematically different feedback to male and female politicians, which lead to a divergence pattern in the propensity to write about the gender topic. Okay? What we did not talk about, by the way, is whether attitudes really change. Okay? The valuation we have in our models are latent variables. We never see them. We only see the behaviors, right? Alex, I have a few more minutes, right? How much time do I have?
Yes, you actually have 10 more minutes if you want.
I have 10 more minutes. Okay, very good. So given that I have a bit more time, let's move on to the third topic that is about the wisdom of the crowd, okay? So what we discussed about so far, okay, in the first two parts of the talk, right, which were they were both about an individual forming beliefs about an alternative on the basis of the information they sample, or the basis of the feedback they obtain, right, and updating their beliefs and making some further decisions about what they should do on the basis of this evaluation, okay. Now, you can look at this slide here. I changed the terminology. I wrote rating here, right? You know, we are going to move on online ratings, okay? But which are a form of evaluation. You can imagine that, let's go back to Julie. She went to a restaurant, she gave 4 stars. She goes again, she had a bad experience. She gives, then she updates her opinion and moves from 4 stars to 3 stars, okay? Now, what we found is that what I said at the beginning, if Julie is operating on her own, she would be subject to a negativity bias, but the environment might alter the negativity bias. Okay? The negativity bias is going to be less strong for popular alternatives, such that popular alternatives will get evaluated more positively. So now, what I want to do here is I want to take the same logic and I want to move to a different level of analysis. Okay? So instead of looking at the evolution of the attitude of one person over time, what we are going to look at is the evolution of the average ratings you can see on Amazon, on TripAdvisor, and so forth. Think of the average rating as a collective opinion. This is so who is the agent here? It's no longer the person. The agent is the community of reviewers. Okay? The community of reviewers has sampled the alternative. Some community members have put their review. Okay? Now, if people care about average ratings to guide their consumption decisions, okay, what does that mean? If the average rating is low, it's unlikely that some more agent will rate the item because they don't want, they're less likely to consume and to buy the product, right? Therefore, they become less likely to publish new ratings. If the average rating is high, more people are likely to have some interaction with the product. They'll go to the restaurant, they'll buy the product. Therefore, some of them will write their reviews, okay? Therefore, the community will have sampled the item one more time, and the opinion of the community will be updated, OK? Some more rating comes in, and now what is the belief aggregation rule? It's simply the arithmetic average of each of the individual ratings here, right? Now, as it happens, if you simulate this process and you assume that one more rating is like more likely to come when the average rating is high, what will emerge is a systematic association between the average rating and the number of ratings. Okay? And this association is spurious. Okay? It does not reflect differences in quality. Okay? You can run the simulations by simulating rating distributions not varying quality, and you will have this systematic association that will emerge. Okay? Now, I'll spare you the simulations. What I want to show you, share with you, is an experiment that is an adaptation of the Salganik-Dodds-on-Watts experiment that I believe all of you, at least all of you, did a PhD or are PhD students in analytics called sociology program. This must be one of your biblical texts. The science paper. Okay. If not, I would strongly encourage you to read it. Okay. So here's our adaptation. Okay. We had participants rate pictures. Okay. From 1 to 5 stars. But what we did here is that we had a bunch of items which were supposedly artists who produced these pictures. Okay. And the artists on the screens were displayed in an order of popularity. Not popularity in the Salganik et al. Sense, which was the number of downloads or number of clicks. Here, our popularity is in, it's a misnomer. We rated the artists in terms of average rating. Artists with high average ratings are on top, artists with low average ratings are on the bottom. So I knew from the Salganik paper that when you do this kind of experiments, people tend to click on the buttons on top. I mean, it's not so surprising, right? So now to create an experimental environment such that items with higher average rating get more reviews, I just put them on top. And by the way, look, we didn't put the actual review, right? We have non-informative names because we also did not want people to be influenced by the quality of the existing average rating. They did not know how these artists were ranked, by the way. Okay. Now, if we do some simulation of exactly this task environment, what we will find is that if an item after a certain amount of time has received more judges, okay, more ratings, okay, it will be evaluated more positively, but if it has received fewer ratings, it will be evaluated more negatively. I mean, it's not so surprising at this point of the presentation. This is likely that the items that the case we see here, right, is an item that got a bad rating and then they are demoted, they are ranked at the bottom, and subsequent agents don't see that. Now, if we do simulations where we're going to assume that low average ratings are on top and people are more likely to click on items with low average ratings, we'll have the opposite pattern. Okay? There will be a negative association between average rating and number of ratings, such that items with few ratings will be overestimated and items with many ratings will not be overestimated. Okay? So what we did here, we did 4 words mimicking the Salganik et al. Experiment. Where 2 words where items with a high average rating were on top, 2 words with items with low average rating were on top, right? In the 2 words on the left, we should expect a positive association between average rating and number of ratings. In the 2 words on the right, we should expect a negative association. And by the way, when there are many ratings, and here, this blue line is the mean of the actual payoff distributions in the simulations, right? When there are many ratings, there is no error, but there is an error of underestimation here, an error of overestimation here on the right side, okay? Okay, so these are our predictions, and here's what we got, our data, okay? So what I'm going to show you on the y-axis is average rating minus quality. So for quality, we again mimicked Salganik et al. We had a set of agents independently rating the pictures. And so what we'll take as quality is 50 ratings, the arithmetic average of 50 ratings for each picture, okay? So for a standard experiment with no interaction, so, okay? So now we are going to look at the difference between average rating and quality on the y-axis and the number of ratings on the x-axis, okay? And here's what we get, okay? In when the high average rating was on top and we expected a positive association, we got a positive association and a negative error for items with few ratings, no errors for items with more ratings. By the way, the gray dot are the dots which are not statistically significant from zero or significantly different from zero. Black dot denotes significant difference from zero at PO5 level. Okay. And in the world where we put the items with a low average rating on top, we have the opposite pattern. Okay. Okay, so yes, selective rating induced by the current level of average rating leads to systematic effect. Fact, right? Systematic errors of underestimation for items that got few reviews, systematic errors of overestimation for items that got many reviews. So, by the way, what's the takeaway from this? If you see a restaurant with few, with bad rating, low average rating, but based on few reviews, you can be quite certain it has been underestimated. No, it doesn't mean it will be the best restaurant in the world, right? But it's quite certain it will be underestimated. Now, what we did is that we complemented this experimental study with some data from Amazon. I'm afraid it's not possible to redo the same analysis now, and you know why in a minute. So we collected rating data, average ratings, and number of reviews for the same products on Amazon France and Amazon Germany. Okay, so now. Under the assumption, and I didn't show you this analysis here, but in many analyses we showed that products with higher average ratings attract more additional ratings. Okay, but what did we predict? Right, if a product has more ratings in Germany than in France, it should have a higher average rating in Germany than in France. Okay, if you have a spurious association between number of ratings and average ratings. And this is what we found, okay? By the way, the products namely were iPad cases, okay, which we selected to be somewhat culturally neutral. We had no prior expectations that Germans and French should have different innate preferences or culturally driven differences in preferences for iPad cases, right? I said before, I don't think we can do the same analysis. We cannot get this data any longer unless you look at the Wayback Machine or historical web data, because now Amazon translates all the reviews and aggregates the ratings across the different websites. Okay? So this was done at a time when if you go on Amazon France, you'd get only the reviews and the ratings published on Amazon France. If you'd go on Amazon Germany, you'd get only the ratings and the reviews published on Amazon Germany. But as far as I get from my everyday experience with Amazon, now they aggregate the data from the various country websites. Okay. So in conclusion, what did we have here in this last study, right? We looked at the process according to which a crowd forms a collective judgment, namely the average rating. The formation of the crowd is endogenous in the sense that more judges join the crowd when the average rating is already high, fewer judges join the crowd when the average rating is low, right? This endogeneity in the crowd formation process leads to a systematic and spurious association between number of judges and the valence of the collective judgment. Systematic positive and spurious association between the average rating and the number of ratings. Okay. Okay, so in summary, right? What did I show you today? I showed you snippets of my research and sampling or selective sampling of information induced by the environment can lead to systematic patterns of beliefs and behaviors, right? In the Spanish politicians and gender issue study, we looked at the feedback provided by the environment and our systematic differences in feedback according to the gender of the politicians can lead to systematic differences in behavior by politicians of the two genders. And in the studies where we talked about the hotels and the Amazon average rating, right? We look at how the social environment can lead to additional exposure of information, right? And how this can lead to a positive association between popularity and valuation, both at the individual level and at the collective level, right? To be clear, these are emergent patterns implied by the dynamics of attitude formations, okay? And belief updating process that people update as a function of the information they sample from their environment. Okay, so let me stop here so that we have enough time for questions and interactions. Thank you for your attention, and I'm looking forward to your comments and questions.
Thank you so much, Gaël. Thank you so much for this very inspirational presentation. We would now like to encourage the audience to unmute if they have any questions. Actually, please raise your hand and I will call by your name to ask the question. Thank you. So let's see. I might have one question just to kick off, if you don't mind.
Okay, very good.
Cool. Well, thank you very much again. It was super cool. Like there is a lot to learn here. And I'm not really like an expert in these like learning models and so on. But I was wondering if you could say something about, there were some models at the beginning of your examples in where you were saying like, in your examples, like there is a person who goes to a hotel and has a negative evaluation. And then that person goes again, and thus there is some function with the popularity, and then the evaluation then is a little bit more positive than before. But I was wondering, usually when we have bad experiences and we go to a hotel or to a restaurant and we have bad evaluations, we don't go back. So it's like they are one-shot games in a way. So I was wondering if you could say something about this kind of phenomenon, like you have one-shot games and then you can have n-shot games where your initial evaluation might be reevaluated n times, but then there might be others in where there's only one opportunity. You go there, you may be influenced by popularity at that time, but then you don't really choose again to go to that place. Does this make sense?
Yeah, exactly. So what you are talking about is essentially an extreme case of the kind of model I'm talking about, mm-hmm. right? So like think of a threshold model, okay? Like you have a two-period, I mean, suppose you have a two-period situation, right? So in the last period, you want to go and if you expect it will be good. In the first period, you don't know if it's going to be good or not, but you know you want to learn, okay? Because so now, if in the first period you got a negative experience, you don't go back in the second period, right? Because in the because you are going to update your assessment, right? And you will expect this to be lower than zero, so to say, right? And suppose we can consider models like Bayesian model. Suppose you know we have a Bayesian agent with you know, completely expected payoff maximizer, who has correctly specified priors on the uncertain parameters of the payoff distributions. We'll have something like that, right? This applies in this setting, right? So you get a bad experience, you don't go, okay, then you know you basically have systematic underestimation. those who have a positive experience, right? Then they go back, okay? So what will we find here, okay? And we can show formally, very easily, that more than 50% of the people, okay, will have a negative experience at the end of this negative belief at the end of the second period.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, this applies. This is-